and Charity and I got married, we both brought two sons into our marriage, so we became a family of six. We both had small vehicles that only sat five people, so whenever we went somewhere, we had to take both vehicles. We began to pray for a breakthrough in our finances because we couldn't afford a bigger vehicle. And the first thing we felt led to do was to change the way we did our giving back to God. And instead of just giving God what we had left on Sunday morning, we began making our offering check, the first check that we wrote every Friday when we sat down to do our bills. And we gave him our first check, and then we still had money to pay all of our bills. We still had money to do the things that we needed to do. We still were not able to save up much in order to get the new vehicle, but we continued to put God first and continued to pray that something would come along. And not too long after that, a Tahoe got parked in a church parking lot with a for sale sign on it, right across the street from Charity's office, and we decided to check into it. So we went and looked at it, and it was exactly what we needed, but the person that owned it wanted $5,000 for it, and we knew that we didn't have $5,000, but we decided to see what we could do and if we could make payments on it. So I called the bank where we had a loan at that was current. We were in good standing with the bank, and they said that they would give us $4,500, and they would just add that amount to the back end of the loan that we already had, so our payments on that loan wouldn't go up. We would just pay them a little bit longer. So we knew that there was another $500 we'd have to come up with in order to get the vehicle, but we thought that was easier than $5,000, so we checked with our insurance and got a quote. And the quote, adding that new vehicle to our policy, was going to increase our monthly payments more than what we were able to afford. So we were looking through the policy, and we noticed that next to Charity's name, it said that she was single. And next to my name, it said that I was single. So when we had gotten married and they combined our policies, they just put them on one policy and didn't change it to a married couple's policy. So we were, in essence, paying two separate insurance policies on our cars. And so when we got that corrected and they added the Tahoe onto it, it actually decreased our monthly insurance payments by $20. So we found out that we would be able to insure it if we bought it. So, still not knowing how we would come up with the extra $500, I went ahead and called the owner of the vehicle and told him that we were interested. And before I could say anything else, he told me that he and his wife had been praying about it and that they would feel comfortable accepting $4,500 for the vehicle, the exact amount that the bank said that they could loan us. So we went ahead and got the loan, and we were able to buy the vehicle, and our monthly payments actually went down $20 a month when we were able to get a new vehicle. And I think that if we hadn't put God first in our giving and in our finances, we wouldn't have been able to come up with that deal.
Awesome. Hey, good morning, Mountain Movers Church. Good morning to our newcomers, and also good morning to those of you watching online.
Today, we are in part two of The Tipping Point. This is a series that we are so excited about teaching because it will absolutely change your life if you get a hold of it. In this series, we're talking about this scale. It's on the graphic, and we've got a little one up here. This scale is God's scale. Whose scale is it?
God's scale.
Whose scale is it?
God's scale.
That's right. It's God's scale. Now, what we're going to be talking about throughout this series is we want the scale to tip in our favor. But what tips the scale? You see, the things that tip the scale are our choices. So the weights that we put into these little scales, there are choices. Every day we get to make for ourselves decisions and choices. And what tips the scale, we're going to tell you throughout this series. But I want to tell you this first. How many of you guys know, I told you last week, the number one thing that people in the world worry about is money.
Money.
money's the number one worry. Did you know that because money is the number one worry, that most people live in financial bondage? They have needs arise that they aren't able to meet. They live in stress and fear as to whether or not they're going to have enough money at the end of the month. They wonder whether or not they're going to be able to pay all their bills, if they're going to be able to keep their homes. And even those people who don't worry about all the bills, they're worried about losing what they have, or that somebody might know that they've got a lot of money and might want some of it. Well, God doesn't want us to live in that financial bondage. He wants us to live financially free. And today we're going to help you to understand that finances is not about money first. Did you hear what I said? Finances is not about money. It's not about the green stuff or the credit cards or the plastic or anything else first. First, money is a heart issue.
Right.
And today we're going to talk about it all being a matter of the heart. If you look in your Bible at Matthew chapter 6 and verse 21, it'll say this: where your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. Money and finances is first a heart issue. We're going to dive right into
this
today.
So we're going to go way back to Adam and Eve. And if you guys will turn with me, we're going to go to Genesis 4. We're going to go verses, we're not going to do all of verses 1 through 12, but as you study your word this week, you might look at that. We're going to start with verse 4 here, and it says, "Now Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain and said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. Then she bore again, this time his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground." Look at verse 3 here. It says, so Abel, and we see here that Abel was a shepherd and Cain was a farmer. Look at verse 3. It says, "And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and their fat. And the Lord respected or accepted Abel and his offering, but he did not respect or accept Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell." So I have a question for you this morning. And that question is, why did God accept Abel's offering and he rejected Cain's? Why did God accept Abel's offering but he rejected Cain's? Did God love Abel more than Cain? So why did God accept Abel's offering and reject Cain's? Well, listen. It's all about the heart. Say that with me. It's all about the heart. Let's look at verse 3 again. "When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord." He presented some of them as a gift to the Lord. But look at this. I want you to look at, as we kind of unpack this a little bit, look at the timing in which Cain offered his offering to the Lord. When you look back in this verse, it says that in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. What this means, when you dig just a little bit deeper in this story, what we find out is that he brought all of this harvest to the Lord at the end of harvest, way after he had already reaped all of the fruit and all the vegetables and all this stuff out of his garden. He brought it to God when it was all said and done, after he had done everything for himself. This was at the very, very end. So in retrospect, if we were to modernize this idea, what it looked like is, okay, I get paid on Friday, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to go out and make sure that all of my needs are met. I'm going to pay my bills. I'm going to run my budget. I'm going to look at how much money I need for the next week or the next 2 weeks, if you get paid every 2 weeks, or maybe even once a month. I'm going to make sure that all of my needs are met. I'm going to make sure I have everything that I need. And then, and only then, will I bring some of an offering to the Lord. So what Cain did is he brought the Lord his last rather than bringing God his first. He brought God his last and his least rather than bringing God his first. And so when we look at his heart, This is the reason why God rejected his offering, because Cain didn't bring God the best, the first. He didn't cut it right off the very top. On payday, Cain didn't say, "All right, Lord, I've been paid. Here's my check for the week. I'm going to pay and give you my first and my best right off the top. I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to trust you. I'm going to believe that you're going to bless the 90%. He didn't do that. Instead, what he did was he looked at himself and his circumstances and his situation. He said, "All right, how am I going to do this? How am I going to survive? I. Basically, what he was saying through his actions is, I depend and I lean on, I trust in, I rely upon myself for my sustenance, for my provision, for my protection. Last time I tried to play God, it really didn't work out too well." A lot of times we try to do things ourselves. We try to work things out for ourselves, and we try to fix problems, and in all honesty, we're nothing. We need God in every area of our life. And Cain really didn't get that. He gave God his very, very last instead of giving God his very, very first and his very, very best. Jude 1 and verse 11, I want you to look at this for a second. "What sorrow awaits them, for they follow in the footsteps of Cain, who killed his brother. Like Balaam, they deceive people for money." That means they are greedy. "And like Korah, they perish in the rebellion." Man, what a strong message where God challenges the heart of Cain. And God is constantly challenging and checking and testing our hearts all the same. God is asking you today, what is your heart like? All right, listen, there are two things that I want to bring to your attention about Cain's heart. If you're taking notes, if you're a note taker, write this down. This is really, really good. There's two things. Number one, thing that we need to look at with Cain's heart is he had greed that had filled his heart. Here's what Cain was saying: "I want more. I want more for me." You see, he was telling God, "I will bring you what I want when I want to bring it." It's not wrong, guys, to desire and want more things for your family. God delights in his people being blessed. Do you know that? You're his children. He loves you. He gets excited. Listen, I can take you back into the Garden of Eden and look at when God created everything, and they said, "It is good." I was thinking just the other day, you know, I was thinking back upon a discussion that I had with a friend of mine. It's funny how people take separate paths. When you leave high school, you know, you enter into this new chapter of life, and all your friends, they go different directions all over the world, and it's neat to kind of reconnect. And I reconnected with a friend not long ago, and he became this big, powerful attorney in Chicago. And he found me on Facebook, and he was following all these posts, you know, where I'm just, you know, just putting it out there how good and how awesome God is. And one morning I made this comment, and it was in no way meant to be, you know, demeaning or disrespectful, but I was simply just saying, I think it's interesting to me how people who call themselves agnostic or atheists can look around at the beauty of creation and say with their lips, "There is no God." I didn't mean anything disrespectful by it. I was simply saying it's amazing to me how you can look around. This morning when we pulled in, man, we get here about 6 a.m. and when the steam is, you know, rising off of the field, and the sun is glistening and just shining on, it's so beautiful. And the smells and the animals and the birds, it's just so amazing how everything intricately fits together. And I was just thinking the other day about how beautiful the smell of flowers are. And I thought, God, you took so much time to get so intricate with us as to give us these beautiful smells, the aroma of flowers, so that we can smell them and enjoy them. And so you're probably wondering what happened in that conversation with my attorney. We got into this all day long debate over Facebook. Nobody ever wins an argument, but maybe I planted a seed. But my point is that it's amazing how you can look at creation and you can look at how beautiful everything is and not realize that God wants us to be blessed. He wants us to enjoy the things that he has given us. So there's nothing wrong with wanting a bigger, nicer house. There's nothing wrong with wanting a nicer car. There's nothing wrong with wanting nice clothes. There's nothing wrong with that unless you put those things first. Put God first, and then those things can come. But put God first. Don't be like Cain, and don't be greedy, and don't say, I want what I want so I can have it, and I want it now. But put God first. It's a heart condition. He was greedy. So we have to put our priorities in line, and then God says, yes, I want you to be blessed. I want you to enjoy your life. The second thing that we look at in dealing with Cain's heart is that he had a heart of rebellion, right? He was all about what he wanted to do when he wanted to do it, right? Regardless of knowing what God wanted, he decided to do what he wanted to do. I'm sure none of us in this room have ever had that sort of an attitude. I'm going to do what I want to do when I want to do it. A heart of rebellion. None of us, right? Don't raise your hand. Right? I remember when I was in the fourth grade and we had a substitute teacher. I love subs because I loved giving them a very, very hard time. I was an interesting student. I drove people to retirement early. It was rough, and it's the truth, but we had this sub, and man, I was giving her a hard time, and we were going out to recess, and you know the red rubber kickballs, right? When you bounce them, they just hit a mile high, right, when you bounce them. And so I was bouncing that ball down the hallway, and she said, Mr. Hilton, please do not bounce the ball inside of the building. I thought, what? Who are you? Okay, this is your first day. Okay, I've been here all year. You're going to tell me not to bounce the ball? Excuse me, hello, hello? Right? So I went to the bathroom with the kickball. Boom! Slammed it on the ground as hard as I could. I thought, she is not going to tell me not to bounce the... Oh, what is falling from the ceiling? What is that? It was the lights that shattered above my head. And so the plastic cover to the light is broken half. It's falling. The ceiling's falling on me. The lights explode. You know those halogen deals? There's this smoke, and all the glass is falling. Ah! I'm screaming. She steps in. She's like, Mr. Hilton, what is going Mr. Hilton, what have you done? I'm like, I don't know. The glass is broken. It just all fell on top of me. Crawled up in the fetal position. I was sucking my thumb. It was bad. She said, Mr. Hilton, did you bounce the ball after I told you? No, why would you call me a liar? I don't lie, okay? Yeah, I bounced the ball. I'm so sorry. She put me in detention, and I had to serve for 4 weeks. I had to help the janitor clean. Is my mom in the building? Mom, are you here? Good. Because I also... Hi, Mom. What's up? What's up, Mama? You're the best mama ever. So my sister forged the detention slip and signed her name. I'm sorry, Mama. True story. She forged it. My sister's going to be here next week. She forged my mom's name. And then I served 4 weeks detention after school helping the janitor clean the entire school. Why? I had a heart of rebellion. I said, you're not going to tell me to bounce the ball or not bounce the ball. I'm going to do what I want, when I want to do it, and you're not going to tell me what to do. I had a heart of rebellion, right? God was saying, Cain, I rejected your offering because you are greedy and because you have a heart of rebellion. Cain had a heart condition. It was all about him and not at all about God.
All right, so look at the other brother, Abel. Some people believe that these guys were twins because when you see in the Bible that she had both of them, theologians believe that they came back to back and that they were probably actually twins. But regardless of that, it's interesting how they not only had different personalities and different careers, but they had different heart conditions. Look at verse 4 as we look at Abel, and he says this, Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock. What part of his flock did he bring? The firstborn, the first of his flock. Highlight that, underline that. And it says, and the Lord respected or accepted Abel and his offering. When we look at these two guys, they're completely different. You see, as Brad said, Cain had a heart of greed and rebellion. His idea was, look, nobody's going to tell me what to do, not even the guy who created me and gave me think about that. The creator of the universe will not tell me what to do. I'll do what I want, when I want, and how I want to do it. God, I'll bring you what I want at the end of my harvest when everything else is done. Then I'll bring it to you. And we see how much God blessed Cain's life for that, if you continue in this story. But Abel, on the other hand, he said, God, I'll bring you what you want when you want it. I'll bring you my first. Now notice, Abel was a rancher, okay? His entire life was wrapped up in livestock. This was the firstborn male, and you have to go back in history to understand it had to be a male was the offering that had to be brought. It was a firstborn male. Now listen to me. If you know anything about raising animals, you've got to have strong male offspring if you're going to produce a herd, all right? So this was really important to him. This was his first male lamb. Was there any guarantee that he was going to have another lamb that was going to be a male after this one? No way. How any of us, none of us, can give life. He can put a male and a female lambs together, sheep together, but he cannot determine whether another male is born. Only God gives life. Only God determines that. But see, here's the amazing thing about Abel's heart. He didn't worry about whether or not he was going to have another male lamb that would produce for the rest of his season and for the years to come. Rather, he said, before that lamb was ever born, he had already predetermined in his mind what he was going to do with it. Follow me, okay? He said already in his mind, God, the first male lamb that is born, it's yours. I don't have to think about it. I don't have to wonder what I'm going to do. It's not like it's born and I'm like, oh no, what am I going to do? God wants my first. He wants my best. No, he didn't have to do that at all because he had already predetermined in his mind. God, I'm going to bring you what you want when you want it. You see, these boys, these were not little boys, okay? These were not kids. These were grown men who owned their own businesses. They both had chosen their own career paths, and these were grown men who had watched their mom and dad, Adam and Eve, bring their first. No doubt they grew up and they heard the stories of how, man, we had it made in the Garden of Eden, boys. But you know what we did? We blew it! We blew it! We messed up! Don't do what we did! Don't do what we did! Man, we disobeyed God, and because of it, man, God had mercy and grace on us, and he killed a lamb, and he made clothes for mom and dad. But don't do what we did! And they would watch their parents bring the first of everything that they produced and bring it to God as an offering. So these guys had grown up and watched this happening, and now all of a sudden, they're adult men. And they're bringing their own offerings. And you see, Cain knew. He knew in his mind what he should do, but he thought to himself, what's the big deal? Really, what is the big deal? I'll bring him a little bit. I'll thank God a little bit, but I'll do it on my own terms. I won't do it on God's terms. And if you go on in the story, you see how Cain got so angry at God. We're going to look at that in just a few minutes. But before we do, I want you to understand the two things about Abel's heart, okay? There's two things that Abel had going for him. Number one, Abel lived by priorities. He lived by priorities. God first. My ranch second. God first. Above everything else, he lived by priorities. And second, you know what he did? He lived by faith. Because if you're going to live by priorities, you are going to live by faith. Because not always do you understand on paper that when I get paid and I take my first and I return it back to God and I give that 10% back to God, my bills don't always line up right. You know, when you heard the story of Jeff and Charity, that is such an amazing story because it takes faith to say, God, I'm just going to put you first. I'm just going to get my priorities in line and I'm just going to test you and I'm just going to see, does this really work? And the answer is yes, every single time. You see, this is the only place in the entire Word of God that he says he can test us. But you know why? Listen to me. God says bring a tenth. And it's because the tenth is a number of testing. All throughout the Bible, you see, we've got the Ten Commandments, the 10 plagues in Egypt, the 10 virgins that brought their oil and were waiting on the bridegroom in the New Testament. Every time you see 10, it's the number of testing. And so God set up the tithe, which means a tenth, as a test. Every single time we have an increase, it's a test of our heart. It's a test to say, God, who will I put first? Will I put my mortgage first? Yes, because I have to have a house. And God says, no, you don't, because I can burn it down if I want to. Right? I mean, seriously, he's like, do you understand I control the universe? I control the unit. You know, it's kind of like parents sometimes. Like, you're trying to get through to your kid, right? And sometimes I just get a hold of my, all my boys have this
and
patch.
And she says,
right,
I control the universe.
No. Oh. Sometimes I get a hold of this patch right here.
Hey, whoa, 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 whoa. Oh. That's happened twice in
wow.
a month.
Wow.
Except that one was half my fault.
I'll be seeing my dentist this week.
You grabbed my...
I was showing
listen,
that
listen,
illustration.
Stop. Time out. Yes. ADD. I am thinning.
I know.
You don't grab the only thing I have left. This is precious to me. Don't grab my hair.
Well, this is what I do with my little boys, not the big ones.
And
but
it takes me half hour to make the front.
I grab a hold of this little patch, and I get right in their face, and I'm like, listen to me. All right? I brought you into this world.
You've heard this.
You understand I can take you out of this
yeah.
world. I rule in
lay
this home
the hammer
over you.
Down.
Right?
That's what I'm talking
I
about.
I think that sometimes God wants to get a hold of the little patch on our head. Maybe that's
don't
what
do
happened
it. Don't
to
Brad, do it.
Right?
Don't do it. Yeah,
God
my mom
got a hold of
my
it.
Mom grabbed this part.
That's right.
Whole life. Your
but
sister
God
forged what? Your sister signed what? Sorry.
I don't think she knew about that. But God looks at us and he says, what are you thinking? Do you not know that I control the entire universe? I control the entire universe. The Bible says in Psalms 24:1, it says this, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to him. It comes down to a matter of our heart. What is our priorities? We have two options. We can either be like Cain or we can be like Abel. We can say, God, I'm going to have a heart that says, I'm going to give you what you want when you want it. And I'm going to trust you with every part of my life. I'm going to believe, God, that you're going to pour out the blessings of heaven upon my home, upon my spouse and my children and my family. You're going to meet all my needs. You're going to protect and you're going to provide because, God, you are in control and I surrender my life to you. Or we can take the flip of that and we can say, God, I'm going to be like Cain and I'm going to bring you what I want when I want to bring it. Nobody will tell me what to do. I will do my own thing. I'll be rebellious and I'll be greedy because I want it all for me. We have that option, and as hard as that is, it's the truth. Look at Hebrews 11:4. It says this. It was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man. What does righteous mean? It means being in the right position with God. And God showed his approval on his gifts. Although Abel is long dead, he still speaks to us by his example of faith. Unbelievable. Today, we're still talking about this man's priorities and his faith. You see, you can look at anybody and you can determine their priorities by looking at two things. All right, you want to know what it is? You look at somebody's calendar and you look at somebody's checkbook and you can tell where their heart is. And if you're wondering where your own heart is, look at your calendar and look at your checkbook because it will determine where your heart is. See, in Malachi 3:9-10, you guys have seen us, you've heard us talk about this before. This is the only place in the entire Word of God that we are told we can test God. Everything else, he says, do not test the Lord your God. But in giving, in tithe, he says this, you are under a curse for the whole nation has been cheating me. Holy cow, I don't want to be cheating God. He says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, here comes the promise. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, the maker and creator of the universe, I will open the windows of heaven for you and I will pour out a blessing so great you will not have room enough to take it in. Try it. Put me to the test. Every Bible I have, that passage is highlighted and circled. Because sometimes there comes a point in your life when you're like, God, I'm putting you to the test because the numbers don't match up. God, there's not going to be enough money at the end of the month for all the bills that I have. But God, I'm going to test you in this and I'm going to put you first and I'm going to give you back in return my 10%. You see, it's not giving because you can't give something that doesn't belong to you. Listen to me. It's returning. If I give you the keys, if I give you the keys to my beautiful vehicle outside.
You going
to
say what it is?
You know what? Just this week, I did a favor for my little brother.
Minivan.
Because I'm just awesome like that. And I took his truck, and I traded him out, and I said, you can have my minivan, okay? He loves to drive my minivan.
And you're so, welcome.
Thank you. And so anytime. I gave him the keys to my minivan, and I took his truck. Now, how crazy would it be if the next day Brandon calls me, and he's like, guess what? I've got you a new minivan. That's right. I bought you a new minivan. And he brings me my keys. And he says, look, I got you a new van. Here you go. How ludicrous would that be? Because I would say, dude, it's not your van to give me. It was mine. I simply loaned it to you. I let you borrow my car. So you're not giving me back my car. You're returning something that's already mine. Are you following me? You're returning something that already belonged to me. When we give back to God, understand this, it all belongs to God. The clothes I have on, the car I drive, the building that's here, our home, everything we have belongs to God. I am not giving back to God because I am so gracious to give back to you, Lord. Absolutely not. I am returning to God because God has given me everything that I have. And all I'm doing is saying, God, I'm going to return back that first portion because you have established everything in my life. And you said you wanted me to bring my first, to show you my heart. I love it. Let's look at the final portion of this passage in verse chapter 4, verse 5 through 8. It says this, but he did not accept Cain and his gift, and this made Cain very angry. And he looked dejected. Why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain, as if he didn't know. Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. Does this not sound like a parent, guys? Man, God is just like, do you understand that when we look at the scriptures and we understand how God deals with us, this is how God wants us to deal with our kids? It is a parenting lesson. He says, look, I will accept your offering if you'll only do what is right. I've told my kids a million times, you will never get disciplined if you do what is right. But God answers and says this to him, but you refuse to do what is right. Then watch out. Sin is crouching at your door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. One day, Cain suggested to his brother, let's go out into the fields. And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel, and he killed him. End of the story. Why in the world did Cain not just surrender to God? Why in the world would he allow his heart to be so hardened even when God said, look, I'll accept you if you just do what is right? But instead, his heart was full of greed and rebellion. And when your heart is full of greed and rebellion, you get angry when someone points out that you haven't done something right. You see, if you have a heart that says, I want to do what's right, I want to be teachable, then when God begins to point out to you and begins to deal with you in your heart and say, hey, this part of your life is not lining up with me. I want you to bring some changes. The teachable heart says, God, Father, forgive me. I want to do what you want me to do. But the person who's angered by it has an issue, has a heart like Cain. I want to tell you that it's not always easy to do the right thing. It's not always easy. I remember many years ago, Brad and I have been married 14 years, and we were in a service one time, and we were worship pastors at this church, and a missionary came in to our church. We were sitting on the front row. We had done worship, and this missionary got up, and he started speaking, and he started telling us about the work he was doing in foreign countries where people did not know about Jesus. And as he began to speak, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, an offering is coming. Like, that's what they do when they bring these, when they bring a missionary in, man, we're supposed to give. And I thought to myself, we already passed the offering plate and we already gave our tithe. We'd already given our tenth. But I thought, God, what do you want us to do? And now, Brad told you last week, if you look in Webster's dictionary under the definition of poor, you would have seen our names. It would have said Brad and Misty Helton. Like, we were the example of poor. And so, at the end of the service, they got ready to pass the offering. And God told me in my mind, he spoke to my heart and said, give $50. Well, what Brad didn't know in that moment and what I did, because I whispered to him and I said, I feel like God's telling us to give $50. And he's like, give it. That's awesome. We only had $50 and some change in our checking account. That's all we had. And this was Sunday. We had already been paid. Okay, there wasn't going to be any more money till the end of the next week. And I thought to myself, I got two choices. I can either do what you told me to do and write the check for $50 and put it in the offering plate and walk out of here feeling great, or I cannot do that and I can walk out of here knowing we have $50 for this week. Now, I have a choice. The choice was already made, though. See, when you've already lived, when you live by priorities, the choice is made when God speaks to you. I wrote the check. I dropped it in. Do you know that week, God blessed us beyond measure that week. Money came in that was completely unexpected. Beyond what we would have had, that little piddly 50 bucks. What would have 50 bucks done? Nothing. It wouldn't have done anything. We weren't going to make it through the week anyway. Might as well give it away and let God bring an increase. You know what I'm saying? When you're poor, the best thing you can do is put God at the first. And if you're rich, the best thing you can do is put God at the first. Because God will open the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing, you cannot contain it when you have the right heart and the right priorities.
Because it's not about money. God does not need your money. Do you think he needs your money? He wants your heart. And our money is connected to our heart. This is about the heart. What is God speaking to you this morning? Here's what God is saying to you right now. What's your heart look like? What condition is your heart in? When Misty and I stand up here and we talk about what the scripture has to say about giving, here's the heart check. Are you ready? Does it get you excited about giving, or do you get angry? If you get excited, you're in the right position with God. If it makes you angry, you have a heart condition. And God wants nothing more than to heal your heart. But it comes with a decision from you to say, you know what, God? Forgive me. I want to give you what is yours. I want to put you first. I want to trust you in my life. And I want to be a channel by which you can flow through and allow your blessings to flow through me. Misty and I are blessed. Notice I didn't say we're rich. We're blessed because we're a blessing. I have a happiness that you cannot pry from my life. Because I'm blessed. It's not because of the amount of money that I make. I know people that make a lot of money and they are not half as happy as I am. It doesn't have to do with my health. It doesn't have to do with my conditions. It has to do with the fact that I am in right positioning with God. He has my heart. And I am completely and totally fulfilled. There is nothing on this planet that can take my happiness away. You can strip me of all the material things, right? My showroom floor minivan, you can take it away. And you won't take my happiness away. I'm happy because I'm blessed, and I'm blessed because God has my heart. Does God have your heart this morning? That's what I want to ask you. Would you stand up with me? Does God have your heart this morning? Have you given him your first? When Misty and I walked in the sanctuary this morning, one of our core values is his presence is our priority. And the Lord spoke so clearly to me this morning. A lot of times it's really easy to come in at 6 a.m. and get right to it. Start work. And go around and set the air and put in the sensies and do everything that we're supposed to do and get up, you know, get our notes going and get ready. There's so much work to do. Guys, there will always be work to do. But God's presence is our priority. And God spoke so clearly to me this morning. He said, Brad, give me your first. And he drew me right into the sanctuary. My head right to the carpet. When I got up, there was an imprint of the carpet on my forehead because we put him first. And it was so amazing. The rest of our time, which was very little, did we not get everything done that we needed to get done? And I'll be very transparent with you this morning, because I'm a human just like you are. There's many times that Misty and I come in and we put work first. I'm confessing that to you. And in those mornings, we are so stressed and so pressed and so rushed and we don't get everything done, and we're frantic, and it literally affects the entire morning of worship experiences. When you invite God first in any area of your life, you are inviting him into that area of your life, and you are inviting him to bless the rest of it. But he wants to be first. So my question for you today is, where's your heart? Where does God line up in the order of priorities in your life? If you would bow your heads with me, please. This morning, I just want to simply ask you, if you're in this room and you would say, Pastor Brad, this message has really, really ministered to me. I feel like God has really spoken to me through this, and I feel convicted. I feel like I have not put God first. I feel like I've had a heart condition, but I want to change right now. I want to make a commitment to God that I'm going to put him first. And nobody's looking around. I have no desire to embarrass anybody. This is just between you and me and God. And I'm just asking you to be very honest and very transparent as I just was. And all I ask is in return that you would do the same. Would you be honest this morning and say, Pastor Brad, up until this point, I have had a heart condition, but from this moment forward, I am going to put God first. Will you raise your hand this morning if that's you? Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your honesty. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? You say, Pastor Brad, I need to put God first. I've not been doing that, and I'm convicted in my heart. I want to put God first. Will you do that this morning? Amen. Thank you. Amen. 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 I want to pray for you. You can put your hands down. I want to pray for you right now. And then in just a moment, we're going to give an opportunity for those of you who don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior to invite him into your heart. But I want to pray for those of you first that have made this commitment to God this morning. Father, I'm so grateful and so thankful for these individuals, God, that have been so honest this morning, God. They have laid themselves out on the line before you, and they've said, Father, I have not put you first, and I apologize, God. I'm sorry. I've had a heart condition, and Lord, I'm praying that you would forgive me right now. I pray that you would wipe it away, Father God. Wipe away the greed, Father God. Wipe away the rebellion. Wipe away the idea, the attitude that says, I'm going to do what I want when I want. Help me, Father God, to have a heart that is set after you. Help us, Lord, to put you first in everything that we do. God, you belong first in our relationship with you. You belong first in our relationship as husband and wife. You need to be first in our finances. I invite you to be first in my body. I invite you to be first in my mind. I invite you to be first in my time. I invite you to be first as I serve in ministry. I invite you to be first. Thank you, Lord, for setting me in that right position with you. Now I am blessed to be a blessing. With all heads bowed and eyes closed, this morning, Misty is going to give an invitation to those of you.
If you're in this house today and you would say, you know, I want to put God first, but I haven't even accepted him into my life. He's not ruling and reigning as Lord and Savior of my life. And if I were to lose my life today, I do not know where I would spend eternity. I want to tell you that today you can make the greatest decision of your life. You can accept Jesus Christ to come into your heart to forgive you of your sins. And you can know for sure that you're going to spend all of eternity with him in heaven. And you can know that God is going to go before you because you are getting your priorities in line. So if you would say today, that's me. I want Jesus Christ to rule and reign in my life. I want the kind of peace that you have. I want the happiness that you guys talk about.
Yes, God.
If you want that in your life,
yes, God.
It's as easy as simply admitting that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, believing in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord,
yes,
and confessing with your mouth that you accept him as Lord of your life. If that's you today, I'm going to count to three, and I just want you to raise your hand. No one looking around. This is just between you and Jesus and
yes,
your pastors.
Lord.
We want to pray for you. We want to know who we're praying for.
Yes,
if
God.
You want to accept Jesus Christ today into your life, it'll be the best decision you've ever made. At the count of three, if you want Jesus, just raise your hand. One, two, three. Do you want Jesus as Lord of your life? Amen.
Amen.
I see your hands. Thank you, Father God. Amen. I see your hand. Best decision you'll ever make is right now, securing your salvation and knowing that when Jesus Christ returns, you have
Thank
a place
you,
in heaven with him. All right, the rest of us, we're going to pray together because we don't want anybody to stand alone. Together, we're going to pray, Father God.
Father God.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
In need of a Savior.
In need of a Savior.
I believe that you are.
That you are.
Who you said
who
you,
you
are.
Who you say you are.
That you came from heaven to earth.
That you came from heaven and earth.
And you gave your life for me.
And you gave your life for me.
Today I ask. That you would come into my
that
heart.
That you would come into my heart.
That you would forgive me of my sins.
You would forgive me of my sins.
And help me to live.
And help me to live.
Every day.
Every day.
For you.
For you, O Lord.
In Jesus' name we
in
pray.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mount Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.